Simon & Schuster Audio presents Cross the Tracks, a memoir by Boosie Badazz. Read by Jaime Lincoln Smith. This book is dedicated to the ones I love and the ones who I have loved and lost. There are a lot of people I have lost in these stories. Special shout out to the babies in the ghettos across the world. To all the prisoners in jail everywhere, you are somebody. Don't give up because you're doing time. I've been there and made the change. To my children who will always be first in my life, Eviana Hatch, Tylasia Hatch, Torrance Hatch, Toriana Hatch, Ivy Ray Hatch, Lyric Hatch, Michael Hatch, Layla Jean Hatch. You mean the world to me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23, New King James Version. I can accept failure. Everyone fails at something. But I can't accept not trying. Michael Jordan. Foreword by Charles Burgess. It is a miracle that Boosie is alive and with us today. In his mid-30s, he has survived being shot at multiple times, teenage fatherhood, a prison term on death row, diabetes, and cancer. He has pulled through it all, relying on his faith in God. It is a miracle for sure that the poor people Dr. King told us not to forget are the same poor people, like Boosie, who created hip-hop, the dominant popular culture on the planet since the late 1970s. Boosie's music is not for everyone. He knew some would not like how raw and real he is, how he speaks about himself, about black people, racism, women, violence, drugs, material things, and life and death. But if you take the time to read this book and truly hear Boosie's words, you will gain a greater understanding of and compassion for what it is to be black and male in these United States. The vast majority of us grew up with little to nothing and had to survive with whatever was in front of us. In hearing his words, you will get without question the story of Boosie's America. Prologue. Welcome to Death Row, 2010. Clang. The sound of iron bars closing me in. News reporters and the local Baton Rouge newspaper, The Advocate, were getting ratings and sales like they'd never seen before. The system had me. They wanted me to spend the rest of my life in jail. They alleged that I'd hired a hitman to commit murder. The same night they accused me of this crime, I was in my studio putting together some tracks to be released. Body Bag and 187 were being cut. Soon the lyrics to my songs would be on trial, as well as my body and soul. No witnesses, a forced confession, and no DNA or physical evidence that would warrant a conviction. But there I sat at a table with my defense attorney, pleading not guilty. Then they used against me the thing I loved most, my own music. Yo, Marlo, he got a Monte Carlo. That bitch Trey, I want that bitch dead. Here go the key. I had spit that lyric metaphorically, as a storytelling. I did not mean I paid someone money to do a crime. Marlo was a friend of mine. During an interrogation, he was told by police that I had even issued a hit on his life for $25,000. Several corrupt law officials were set on making a case for murder. They interrogated this young man for hours, fabricating lies, then only recording what they wanted the courts to hear. And in even deeper speculation, they interpreted a tattoo on his arm to mean he was my hitman for hire, waiting on me to issue orders for him to carry out. I was being charged with the murder of Terry Boyd. He was the uncle of my child that I'd fathered with his sister. The district attorney's case suddenly tanked when Marlo finally got on the stand and told under oath how the police had obtained his confession. Right after that, the police took the stand and denied what Marlo had said. I knew all this was in retaliation for a track I'd released called Fuck the Police. In it, I mentioned almost every branch of law enforcement I could possibly think of, including the FBI and the district attorney. I had made them look bad, so they wanted revenge. That would have been their justice, to see me facing lethal injection. Got old, it got worser. My hustle got deadly, running and ducking from that dirty bitch, Don Kelly. That was a lyric in the first verse of Fuck the Police. Don Kelly went on to become Captain Donald Kelly, giving the city 32 years of service. My verses told the tale of how they would pull me over and try to extort me for money. I went on to let them know how I felt with the chorus line. Cities, fuck 'em. Narcotics, fuck 'em. Feds, fuck 'em. DAs, fuck 'em. We don't need you bitches on our street. Say with me, fuck the police. Fuck 'em. Fuck the police. Fuck 'em. Without that badge, you a bitch and a half nigga. I believe this song and the two songs I created the night Terry Boyd was gunned down were the seeds of a hate relationship between me and the Baton Rouge Police Department. Not because they had evidence linking me to a murder. Not because they had their bogus statement. But because I had exercised my freedom of speech. Because a black man had spoken truth to power in the American Deep South. Chapter 1. Badass Boosie, South Baton Rouge, the beginning. Cross the tracks is what we call my hood. Being raised there gave me the morals I live by, my values on family and life, and most of all, my codes for hustling. As far back as 8 years old, I was hustling. It's just what people from my neighborhood did. My partners and I started knocking off the Circle K gas stations. We would stop there daily before hitting the schoolhouse. We would clean their candy aisles out, planning to sell what we stole. More than books, product lined our backpacks. Snickers bars, Reese's cups, and all the flavors of now and laters. It became an easy $30 to $40 a day hustle for us. As an 8-year-old have not, that was a lot of paper to be in your pocket. We were getting it. After school, we would hurry to the crib to jump on our bikes. Riding our bikes all over town was our shit. I considered myself fortunate to even have a bike, especially since my father, Raymond Hatch, was a user. He played with the monkey, but I guess the monkey wasn't on his back like for most people who used. Raymond always made sure home was straight to the best of his abilities. Me and my dudes all had reflector fetishes. It was a big thing back in those days to be riding your pedal cruiser with the sun beaming the brightest off your front wheel. Of course, whoever got the most reflectors was deemed the man by the neighborhood girls. I stole so many damn reflectors. You get the point. We'd ride until our stomachs growled with hunger, and there was only one place in town we would stop, Mrs. Mueller's place. If you had $6, you didn't need McDonald's or Burger King. Mrs. Mueller was so good at cooking that she should have had her own golden arches and her own slogan. Over a billion ghetto plates served. Her fried turkey wings and deep fried pigtails could have put any casual dining chain out of business. Her dilapidated home was like a real restaurant, and she made sure she had something for everyone's taste and budget. Flavored Dixie cups for the shorties and an assortment of different candy. She even had pickles for the girls who liked to put peppermints down inside them and suck the juice. Hell, Mrs. Mueller even sold pig lips if that was what you liked. She was one hell of a cook and definitely a boss hustler. So much came with the good, and so much more came with the bad. Crime, guns, and homicides plagued my environment like they were a natural part of life. Guns were easy to come by, entirely too easy. When I was just 9 years old, my cousin shot my other cousin with a handgun. I had always thought all that blood you see in the movies was just some fugazi red coloring to make the scene more intense to sell more tickets. How could a person bleed out so much and survive? But that day I saw that shit was for real. My cousin didn't die, which was a good thing, but he sure spent 4 months in the hospital. That was the first really violent thing I saw in my early years. Every kid had someone they looked up to. With drug dealer role models like Calvin Ricks and Kenny Wayne, there was always something to see. These big ballers were the men who had it going on, and they controlled the streets. They were like the black Pablo Escobar and El Chapo. At 11, what most would consider to still be a tender age, I witnessed my first murder. My friends and I were parked across the tracks like we normally would be after doing our bullshit, things like riding our bikes up to Louisiana State University or hanging out at the game room. Sometimes we'd just cruise to the levee to throw rocks at cars passing by. That was when we were on some really dumb shit. There were times when we felt like young players and would hit the Roosevelt Projects to either chase a young cutie pie to see how far we could get or just mess around and play some basketball. On this particular day, we were just chilling on our bikes. We watched the local kingpins making their money. The air smelled like rain, even though the sun was shining bright. In the dirty South, you never knew what Mother Nature is up to. Like any other woman, she always has her own agenda. Rain one day, sunny the next, or sending hurricanes like Katrina through to show who is the real boss. Baton Rouge was known to go from sunshine to a flood in a heartbeat. While chilling on the railings, we peeped a dude rolling up slow and smooth on his bike. He was calm and cool. The dude he was approaching was also chilling and none the wiser, until the rider called his name like he was his friend. The target turned around, and all you heard was, pop, 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 pop. The orange blaze blossomed out the barrel of the pistol as the first four shots entered the target's chest, then sent the helpless man tumbling over. Just to be certain, the shooter let loose two more rounds up close. The deal was sealed, and the victim was a dead man. What's crazy is it wasn't out of the ordinary for things like that to happen. In my hood, that was normal, everyday life. Across the tracks had seen endless mayhem and murder. It felt like the thing to do when my friends and I went over to the corpse and emptied the dead man's pockets. Chapter 2. Growing up in the bloody red sticks. Hustling was a way of life for real. There was always gambling and drug selling, which were a given, but one legitimate hustle in my hood was food. I've already spoken on Mrs. Mueller, who had the everyday food business on lock in the community, but people also did what we call suppers. These were gatherings where someone would throw down on the grill or prepare dishes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.